Hello viewers and dear students. Today we are going to see a topic from paleontology, organic evolution. I am Dr. Sajid Undekar, Associate Professor in Head, Department of Geology, AKIs, Pune College of Arts, Science, Commerce, CAMP, Pune, Maharashtra, India. It is affiliated to Savitribai Phule Pune University, that is SPPU Pune, Organic Evolution. So, for why we want to study the organic evolution? It is essential to understand the whatever the today's living body is there and whatever the thing which has happened in the past, we have to know that thing and we can make out a planning for the future. So, keeping in mind present is a key to the past, we can find out whatever the process, living things which are there, and we will study what are the things which are living. And that is the important opportunity to study the intricacies of the problem. So, what are the problems are there? What are the keys are there? What are the main causes are there for the related to the origin of the life and for the evolution of the life? So, that will be a very, very important one, and it will help in preparing the evolutionary train through the geological column. So we have various evolutionary theories are there and which are put forth, and we are going to see the various evolutions are there, whether elephant is there, horse is there, camel is there, dinosaurs, whatever we have the animal, even lamellibranch, brachiopods, cephalopods or corals are there, how they have been evolved. We will see the evolutionary tree with this. We will see how this particular animal or plants will be from time to time they have been evolved, why they have been evolved, what are the reasons are there, we want to know. So that's why there are this particular branch is a very, very important one for the paleontologists, that is the organic evolution. And there are the merits are there, there are the demerits are there. So we want to have with the merits, we want to study that particular organic evolution. So fossil is the immense source. So from where we can study this organic evolution, that is the tool is fossil. Second one, rock. Whatever the fossil is there, it is there in the rock. So these fossils are immense source of information and giving you a light how this animal is living in the past, whichever the age has been dated now with the help of that particular thing. First we'll study is morphology is there, the appearance is there, what will be the existence is there, what is the diversification is there, what will be the paleoclimatic condition, paleo-environmental condition which will be suitable for that plants and animal which are there in that particular world. So that is very, very important for the study of that particular evolutionary part, for the appearance, existence and diversification. So fossil record is a very, very scanty record we have on the surface of the earth, and through that scanty record we are then going to construct the geological time scale and whatever we have the evolutionary theory we have been put forth, whatever the thing which we have been given, that is the still we feel that it is incomplete, but still we have to search for the fossil, and whatever the thing which we got, we can update that particular information all over the world. Therefore, one has to take a proper stock of the present occurrence distribution of the living organism while attempting the evolution related problem. So that is the present is the key to the past. We have seen if you want to study any particular fossil, say example elephant, you want to study as the evolution. So today whatever the elephants are there in the world, we have to first know their morphological details are there, and after that only we can go and find out what are the past 100 years, 200 years, million years back, how these animal has been living and how it has been evolved from that particular position to the present position. If so, the biological phenomena must be going hand in hand related to information of the fossil record. What will be the physiology is there, how was the shape is there, whatever the thing which have been changed that particular of that organism, we have to see into the detail. So further, depending upon many factors, most important is the preservation. So here not only we are going to study the fossil, we want to see that at the time why this particular animal is dead, what is the main cause for that, then duration at the time of deposition, what will be the sediments are deposited, what will be the environmental condition, and in which environment that particular animal or plant has been survived, and why it has been, root causes are there for its death, we will try to identify. The biological phenomena can be very well understood taking Darwin's theory of natural selection, but nowadays Darwin theory, as most of them, the scientists are there, they are rejecting, but still it is an important one. Most of dominant thought, survival for the fittest, hold the key for the this problem. That is the very, those who are the fittest, whatever the changes which are taken place in the environment, that only is going to sustain, otherwise is going to dead. So depending upon each and every individual's ability to adapt to their surrounding, that is a very important. Nowadays we have been only giving that the climate change is there. Might be we are there in the next what we have, the extinction episode, which may be are there, might be how many years it will be there, we don't know. But if anything is going to happen, worst thing is happened, then if ice on the Antarctica is started getting melting, then most of the countries which are there, they're completely going to submerge. So that is the threat which is there. So we have to see that those which are the living on that particular, what will be the surrounding, we have to check. So the present is the key. So whichever thing which you have seen, that why these extinctions happened, whether the dinosaurs or the ammonites are extinct, why the non-flowering plants have been extinct. So their root causes we have to find out, and we want to see that whether we can apply within this particular present as well as in the future, so that we can whatever the threats which are going to face by these present generations, they can adopt and they can sustain that particular or they can avoid that particular what we have the major extinction. A careful or critical analysis of these automatically take care of these variation involved in this. Thus evolutionary process can be understood by very well by taking two things into the consideration: the date of evolution through which the geological scale has been prepared, the second one, pattern of evolution and diversification. Date of evolution through the geological scale, so we are going to make out the dating, how many years back it has been dated. Similarly, what is the pattern of the evolution is there, what if, where is the diversification is there, that these two points are very very essential for the organic one. These would be enable anybody to understand the evolutionary pattern of the individual, that is called as a branch is called as ontogeny, or a particular community or a group, it is called as phylogeny. So remember those who are there, MCQs, ontogeny and the phylogeny. So remember these two definitions. Then the next one, what is a microevolution, macroevolution? Does evolution only happen gradually through the small changes, or it may be possible a drastic environmental change can be cause new species to evolve, or can both the small and large changes can occur? So anything will be happen. That the first one, anything gradually changed. So say now we are going to say the climate change is there, but as go on increasing the climate change, might be suddenly there 5-6 degree has gone. So most of the animal who could not sustain that, they will be extinct. Similar one, there is a possible that drastic environmental change can occur, or to the new species to evolve, that may happen, and can both the small or large changes can occur. So that we have to see, the evolutionary changes can be both, that is the big as well as the small. So we have to keep into the eyes and open your mind, and we have to study that particular evolution of what is, whether it is a micro or a macro evolution is there. Some evolutionary changes do not create new species, but result in changes at the population level. So whatever the population is there, it may be decreased or it may be increased. That may be happen. Population is a group of organism of the same species that live in the same area. That is what we have the definition of a population. But what exactly is the definition of a species? Species is a group of organism that have similar characteristics. Yes, if we say the species is there, then that will be a similar characters group is their organism. They can are genetically similar and can mate with one another to produce the fertile offspring. To understand the above things, we have what to be know the types of environment that are existed around us. So we should know what are the environments we are there, so present, so that we can keep in mind and we can apply into the past. We know that a species is a fundamental unit in the taxonomic identification. Therefore, its immediate relation with the surrounding which result involving a new species fit in existing slot may called as micro. So microevolution. We know the species is the fundamental unit in the taxonomic identification. Therefore, the intimate relationship with surrounding environment involving into a new species fit in the existing slot may called as the microevolution. Microevolution result change within a species. An example of microevolution is evolution of mosquitoes that cannot be killed by the pesticides called pesticide resistant mosquitoes. Imagine that you have a pesticide that kill most of the mosquitoes in your state. Through a random mutation, some of the mosquitoes has resistant to the pesticide. As a result of the widespread use of this pesticide, most of the remaining mosquitoes are the pesticide resistant mosquitoes. When these mosquitoes reproduce the next year, they will produce more mosquitoes with the pesticide resistant trait. That is the best example shared with you. Soon most of the mosquitoes in your state are resistant to the pesticide. These examples of the microevolution because the number of mosquitoes with the trait changed. However, this evolutionary change did not create a new species of the mosquitoes because the pesticide resistant mosquitoes can still reproduce with other non-pesticide resistant mosquitoes. So regular as well as the resistant mosquitoes which are there, pesticides, they have been produced. The microevolution refers to much bigger evolutionary changes. Macro means the bigger one. The macroevolution refers to the bigger evolutionary changes that result in new species. When micro occurs repeatedly over a long period of time, leads to the creation of new species. As a result of major environmental change, as a volcanic eruption, earthquake, or an asteroid hitting the earth, which changes the environment so much that natural selection leads to large changes in the traits of the species. On other hand, the macro evolution refers to the evolution of higher taxonomic. However, it is not easy to draw a line between micro and macro. Yes, that is a very, very difficult to draw a particular line that before that this is the micro and the rest one is the macro evolution. So phenology has to show that in general the evolution favors the theory. That is the only that we can mention. There are number of fossil records show abrupt faunal continuity which either indicates migration or extinction. That will be the Wegener have been given the theory for the continental drift. So that will be the best example which are there. However, the best possible fossil record is noted down the adaptive radiation that would lead to understand the speciation, population, dynamics, ontogeny, the phylogeny and associated ecosystem. Molecular paleontology, a modern branch, has added a new dimension in the study of the organic evolution. So now that's whatever the branch is there, the molecular paleontology has now evolved because of that particular dimension of the study of organic evolution. Now what is a metazoan life? The life on the earth begin little more than 3.1 billion years ago. It is presumed that the most primitive form of the life was prokaryotic in nature, and these are the evidence of abundance stromatolites in the late pre-Cambrian times. If we assume that these stromatolites form the base and were responsible for the later diversified animal life, then it will be easy to visualize the life in the fossil record. And these are the stromatolites are the best example which have been we have the example from the Australia. Initial radiation of the life might have resulted through oxygen liberated from the stromatolites. Incidentally, the modern stromatolites along with algae surviving in the hypersaline lagoons of Shark Lake, Western Australia is an best example of great value. Paleontologists put their brain into unreveal the mystery of earliest metazoan group of living organisms, that is Ammonia, that is bacteria, blue-green algae and green algae, prokaryotes and Protista, Plantae, Fungi and Anemia are the five major radiations and proliferated during the subsequent Earth history, including the modern one. Now the life through the Precambrians. Late the Precambrians, we know that the whatever geological time scale is there, in that we have been broadly, this geological time scale has been broadly divided into two categories. One we called as the Phanerozoic and one is we have the Cryptozoic. And where we have the Cryptozoic is there is no life. We are saying that we don't have the fossil records. And the second one is Phanerozoic, where we have going to get the abundant of, or there will be a fossil abundance is there. So first one Precambrian is before the Cambrian, these, that is the Precambrian is the lowermost division of the Paleozoic, that is the Phanerozoic, the lower what we have the period is there, and before that whatever is there is earlier is called as Archean, or it is called as a Proterozoic, Azoic, but nowadays it is simply called as the Precambrian. So late Precambrian Proterozoic, that is between 2500 to 570 million years. So that is the range. Huge age is there of that particular duration, late Precambrian to the Proterozoic. And that has been celebrated. Edikara fauna of South Australia is the most fascinating example of the Precambrian life. The fauna mainly consists of varieties of jellyfishes and soft corals or the phylum Cnidaria or worms. In addition to these, the trace fossils, especially burrows of soft body organisms such as termite, are also common in the Precambrian sediments. And the Proterozoic shells, the churns invariably contain most possible algae cells. These mostly represented by the red and green algae, that is the Rhodophyta and Chlorophyta especially. Now we'll see the life through the Paleozoic, that is in the Phanerozoic they have been divided into Paleozoic, Mesozoic, Cenozoic, where Paleozoic is called as primary, so then Mesozoic called as the secondary, and whereas Cenozoic is called as tertiary. And the primary or Paleozoic which we have, it has been divided into Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous and Permian. So these are the division. You have to remember from the bottom: Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous and Permian. So now we will start from the lower side, that is the lower Cambrian, that is lasted for 10 million years. So 1 million is 10 lakh. You can now calculate the how many years are there, and our life is just hardly average. We are making that 60 in what we have the Indians. But if you go for the Japanese, around they have been 90 to 100. Then the US it is 80 to 90. So these are the, depending upon what are the environmental conditions which are there, which are very well suitable in to these two countries. But in India, we have a lot of contamination, a lot of pollutions are there. So due to that, we have the life average is come to the 60. But now here, it is 10 million, lower Cambrian is 10 million year, and fossil record reveal that the occurrence of calcareous algae, protozoans, sponges, corals, bryozoans, brachiopods, molluscas, trilobites, echinoids, graptolites and conodonts. These are the things we are going to get into this particular lower Cambrian. Besides this, a major group, there are occurrence of some groups, uncertainty will be there. Calcareous algae, that is Cyanophyta, blue-green algae, that is called as blue-green algae is called as Cyanophyta, mostly occur in Paleozoic rock, and earliest record being formed, the lower, that is lower Paleozoic, that is the part. Families like the Solenophoresis and Gymnocordiasis, both extinct of extinct of the Rhodophyta, red algae had wide occurrence in Paleozoic. However, family like Squamiriaceae probably occurred in late Carboniferous, and Chlorophyta, green algae represented by families like Cordiaceae, Dasycladiaceae appeared mostly during the mid-Cambrian Ordovician period. But the family Chlorophyceae have more continually recorded from late Siberian with more variation during the Devonian to Carboniferous time. Protozoans are not much diversified till the end of the early Cambrian. They were mainly represented by two groups, Foraminiferida and Radularia. The Foraminiferida were commonly represented by Textulariae and Fusulinina. Sponges were represented by Archosidiatheria, Hexaactinellidia, then Demospongia, Calcarea, Stromatoporoids, and the Chaetatida. Corals were represented by the class Tabulata or Rugosa. Bryozoans are the colonial organism. They were very common in the mid-Paleozoic in the form of branch, hemispherical, encrusting colonies under the order of Tryptostoma. Besides, these other types of bryozoans possessing various shapes and size are also common. Fossil brachiopods show that these organisms are abundant in the great diversity in Ordovician and in the late periods. However, there is no fossil records of transition from the presumably worm-like organism to the brachiopods or early Cambrian period. Then lingulates and orchidoids were appeared in early Cambrian rocks. Other brachiopods belonging to the order Stromomerida, Pentamerida, Rhinolidida, Artipida, Spirifida, and Textulida were also present in the Paleozoic time. Molluscas were also common in the Cambrian Sea, however, diversity was very low. Early bryozoans were Ostoconchia class reported from Cambrian and Permian times. Early Paleozoic have given rise to primitive cephalopods which were lacking poise. They were either slightly curved or straight. Some commonly occurring cephalopods were Actinoceratoids, Ascoceroids, and the cephalopods from the late Paleozoic belonging mainly to the order of Goniatitids. The early gastropods were also less than 10 mm in size, and their common occurrence were observed during the Devonian. The most genus was Ormotoma of the suborder Murchisomina. The occurrence of orthopods outnumber and any other phyla. Interesting, the trilobites had drawn the greatest attention during the excellent fossil record. The primitive trilobite genus Olenus are most dominant element in the early Cambrian time, and the Ordovician time has witnessed the proliferation of trilobites and disappeared by the end of the Permian period. So at the end of Paleozoic, they are totally extinct. So the Cambrian will be called as the golden era of the trilobite. Then the Ordovician will be called as the graptolite. So these are the golden periods are there. Carboniferous, we have the non-flowering plants. They are the dominating over there in the Carboniferous. Echinoderms are another important group of fossil which have invaded the Paleozoic era. During that particular sea, of all the main groups of echinoderms, the crinoids occur in the present sea too. Graptolites are mainly represented by bush-like forms with many branches. This group become common during the Ordovician period. They are used as an index fossil for the Ordovician and the Silurian sediments. They decline in number after the Silurian and many become extinct. Among the microfossils, ostracod 2 are common in the early Cambrian sediments and especially represented by the smooth forms. Conodonts have their own significance in the Paleozoic history. They have been wide geographic distribution, and the limestone of Ordovician and Silurian time show diversity and speciation shows ranges of different invertebrates. Critical analysis of the Paleozoic invertebrate revealed that rich and diversified Idikaran fauna is celebrated documentation of Proterozoic and Cambrian life. Especially the later Paleozoic period has witnessed the diversified invertebrate fauna. From the above discussion, it is clear that the entire Paleozoic era was dominated by invertebrate. Hence, it is referred as era of invertebrates. The Paleozoic vertebrates commonly consist of quadrates, fishes, amphibians, and the reptiles. The fossil record of fish is inadequate to comment upon its evolution and diversity. However, the fossil record indicates that the number of taxa was highest in Devonian and also in the lower Carboniferous. The late Paleozoic fishes did not show any diversification till Triassic period. The fossil record of the fish is inadequate to comment upon its evolution and diversity. However, the fossil record indicates that the number of taxa were highest in the Devonian and also in the lower Carboniferous. The late Paleozoic fishes do not show any diversification till Triassic period. Similar to the fishes, amphibians also show their peak occurrence in the Carboniferous. They appear in the late Devonian and become common in the Permian and in the Triassic. These include the amphibians of terrestrial, semi-terrestrial and marine environments. Reptiles evolved from the amphibians during the Carboniferous and Permian time. It appears from the fossil record that the land plants evolved during the Silurian to Devonian time. During the Middle Devonian, there were rich forests of vascular and seedless pteridophytes plants. During the Carbonation period, there was a luxuriant growth of vegetation and seed-bearing plants. The spermatophytas came into the existence. However, the late Paleozoic flora extensively distributed in the Carboniferous period and mainly belonging to the Lycophyta, Spenophyta, ferns, gametosperms, tendos, spermatophytes, conifers and quadrates. Important genera are Sigmaria, Lepidodendron, Sigillaria, Calamites and Annularia. With this we have been completed the Paleozoic. Now we will come to the era what we have, the Mesozoic era. So in that we are going to have, first we will see about the invertebrate fauna. Soon after the Paleozoic era, there was a general recession in the faunal and the floral productivity till the early Triassic period. In true sense, the expansion took place in Jurassic and has a wide witness, varied and diversified fauna. Many new groups started appearing to achieve their peak of abundance in tertiary. Beside the Foraminifera, both planktonic as well as benthonic, the coccolith, diatoms, dinoflagellates, acritouch and radularia have shown their frequencies during the Mesozoic. However, the most of the trilobites disappear by the end of Paleozoic, hence do not represent it in the Mesozoic. Similarly, graptolites are a decline in number gradually in Paleozoic, but many articulate brachiopods survive through the Mesozoic. Bryozoans were declining in number through the Permian till Triassic time, started increasing number after the Jurassic. By the end of Cretaceous, again there is a appeared in good number and variety. Cindarian, that is the anthrozoans, increase in number. Prostita, which shows acme in the tertiary almost with the same frequency during the Cretaceous. Echinoids evolved during the Mesozoic and show more number and diversity. Conodonts are not seen after the Triassic. The other mega invertebrates, new coral, Cerecantina, gave appearance in the Middle Triassic. Many diverse groups such as bivalves, rudis become common. Graptula, gastropods became more common in Mesozoic, particularly in the genera Murex and Ephora. Ammonites became the most fascinating too far for biostratigraphic purpose during the Devonian to the terminal Cretaceous. So at the end of the Cretaceous, ammonites are extinct. Its rapid evolution and change resulted more than 130 zoons in the sediments of late Paleozoic as well as the Mesozoic period. Interesting, the extinction of ammonites coincide with the mass extinction of the giant reptiles and some microorganisms have generated a discussion over this topic. And as a result, there is quite a good explanation for the mass extinction have appeared in the publication. So there is the mass extinction which has been happened during the Devonian, then the Silurian, then the Permo-Carboniferous period, that is a PT boundary, then we have the KT boundary. So there are the five, and might be we are there in the six. So you are going to get a video on that, the whatever the major extinctions which are happened on the surface of the fifth, and what will be the future. That will be shortly, it will be uploaded. Those who are interested, they can go and check it on this channel. Now we will see the vertebrates. No other geological period is as fascinating as the Mesozoic. This is the only period which has witnessed the diversity in the land, sea and air animals. These include dinosaurs, reptiles, crocodiles, lizards, turtles and snakes. Hence, Mesozoic is referred as the golden age of reptiles. Dinosaurs, we will see particularly dinosaurs. The fossil evidence of diversity within the dinosaurs are not adequate to understand it precisely. The available fossil record indicates that a major dinosaurian explosion in the middle and the late Triassic. There are specific changes in the shape and size of the dinosaurs since the evolution of Storiporosaurus, probably the earliest known animal from the middle Triassic. Of all the dinosaurs, the size of the herbivorous dinosaurs are much larger than the carnivorous ones. The former is represented by more commonly occurring Cretaceous genus Dinosaurus and the late Triassic Zolopitia, while the late is represented by Diplocos, Jurassic and Cretaceous period. Jurassic genus is Fagrosaurus, Stegosaurus, and the occurrence of the Pterosaurus flying reptile is another remarkable feature of the Mesozoic period. The late reptile Archosaurus was adapted to air too. These reptiles are not only restricted to the land or air, but evolutionary adaptation has represented dominant aquatic reptiles. Among the aquatic reptiles, Pithosaurus stands for the highly specialized nature and commonly reported from the Triassic period beds, and the reported Nothosaurus and Pleothoras dinosaurs show very gradual adaptation towards the aquatic habitat. The fossil record of the bird is incomplete, and the most primitive bird fossil is Archaeopteryx, is known as Jurassic limestone of Germany. The fossil birds are also reported from Cretaceous rock, mainly Thornis and Hesperornis. So the mammal-like reptiles are known from early Triassic period, but two mammals evolved during the late Triassic. Most Mesozoic mammals were small, and most primitive studies are concentrated on the dimension of brain, teeth and the jaws. More of the Mesozoic period has witnessed the bloom of cycads and cycadaroid, and the fossil records show the common occurrence of leaves, trunks of cycads. The cycadaroids did not appear beyond Cretaceous. The Mesozoic has another distinction of possessing abundance of flowering plant angiosperms, and it was during the early Cretaceous. During the Neocomian, Barremian, Aptian, Albian, there was a tremendous bust of frowning plants. A careful look in look at the fossil record of gymnosperms, seed ferns, and cycads and cycadioids. It was very difficult to answer the fossil occurrence of flowering plant in the Mesozoic. Nevertheless, paleobotanists believe that there must be a combination of factors such as efficient physiology, reproduction rate, and adaptability that present the most probable answer for the angiosperms in the Cretaceous period. That completes the what we have, the Mesozoic one, dominance of the reptiles, and the ammonites will be there. Now come to the Cenozoic. Cenozoic era is called as era of mammals, but the invertebrates are not far behind them. In fact, the arthropods, lamellibranchs, gastropods, protists, bryozoans, anthrozoans reached their climax in the Tertiary period. However, the articulate brachiopods declined. Echinoderms maintained their Mesozoic frequency. Gymnolamita, that is the biota, reached their climax in Tertiary. The study of Cenozoic vertebrates is comparatively easy because of the most of the vertebrates which appear in the late Mesozoic and Cenozoic belonging to some of the modern families. In other words, most of the living genera and species have originated from the late Mesozoic and Cenozoic mammalian stock and hence facilitated to establish the more meaningful links between them. The fossil record show quite good occurrence of sensital and marsupial mammals from the South America and Australia. The former represented by the bear-like bothinids, dogs and cats, while the Tasmanian devil wolf characteristics of the latter. The fossil occurrence of the bat is also significant in the Cenozoic. Many of the bat genera are attributed to have evolved in Oligocene. Eocene fossil records show the highly specialized bat acquiring modern skeletons. In addition to this, there are fossil records from the South Africa indicating elephant shoes characterized by a very small mouse size insectivorous possessing the long snout. The primates have their own place in Cenozoic vertebrates. Primates, they are studied extensively because they include fossil record of Homo and our own genus. Although there are extensive fossil reports, but their study is far from satisfactory to build a lineage. This is mainly because there are missing links and their preservational conditions were also not congenial. A review of the literature on the subject revealed that the fossil primates have probably entered South America around Oligocene. Among the Paleocene primates, the Pelecypedapi forms are primitive ones which resemble the rodent in possessing large size incisors and a considerable gap between them and the teeth. Significantly, the Oligocene period has witnessed another radiation of evolution called Anthropodia, which includes monkeys, apes is there, and man, and the advanced primates. Fossil records show that Miocene is the period where the hominoids, especially the primitive ones, originated in Africa. The African genus is known as Caniopithecus, and it was followed, it's a wide radiation in the late Miocene into Europe and Asia. Asian genus is known as Sivapithecus, while European is known as Theopithecus. In the absence of any fossil record, gorilla, it is believed that the hominidas was resulted from Caniopithecus. Australopithecus afarensis, probably the first species of hominids from Africa, was ape-like. Subsequently, there was many more species of Australopithecus showing gradual increase in size of the molar teeth and the area of the jaw musculus. Fossil records show Homo habilis is the first variety of genus Homo reported from Eastern Africa of some 2 million years ago. This was followed by appearance of Homo erectus and Homo sapiens. Homo sapiens. Carnal capacity of modern man is 1300 cc, heavier facial feature, broad ridges and shorter stature. Homo erectus, cornical capacity 850 to 100 1000 cc, commonly reported from Africa and Asia. Homo habilis, cornical capacity 700 cc, long arms and short legs. In addition to this, modern mammals fauna commonly consists of bears, tigers, dogs, hyenas, lions. Fossil evidence show that diversification of these groups during the early Cenozoic. Besides, these birds during the Cenozoic had wide geographical distribution in the South America and the northern continents. Overall population above mentioned carnivores can group into the orders the Carnivora, modern ones, and the Cnidonites, that is extinct one. Cnidonites include 114 genera, the Oxynidae and the Hynodontidae family, comprising the Carnivora, consists approximately 400 genera. Rodents and rabbits are also appear in the great variety in China, Asia. Similar to the radiation of land animal, the diversified marine life consists of sea lions, seals and walruses under the suborder Pennipedia, originated probably from the North Pacific and Atlantic Ocean, Mediterranean Sea during the early Cenozoic. The next one, ungulates or hoof mammals. The early Cenozoic period had witnessed the diversified mammals such as horses, cows, elephants probably originated from North America, spread out Asia, South America, Africa. The South American ungulates shows major group, the horse-like mammals and the camel-like mammals. Elephant too evolved is in quite a good number in and varieties. Their wide geographical distribution in Europe, Asia and America is significant. The plate tectonic movement during the Miocene has established a line connection between Africa and Asia, which has resulted in the spreading of elephants over a wide geographic regions including Asia and Europe. This has also resulted in many elephant lineages. Modern elephants are grouped into two groups, African genus and other genus from the Asia. Another significant feature of the period is that appearance of pigs, hippos, camels, deer-like forms, deer, sheep, and antelopes. These animals dominated the north continents during the early Cenozoic. At the time progressed, the diversification of these above mentioned groups diversified significantly in the Eocene. All these animals have grouped into the Antidactyl. This group is also include giraffe, bird, mountain sheep, goats and bison. In addition to this, the other group major pachycephalodactyls dominated consists of rhinosaurs, tapirs and horses. These animals too appear in the Eocene. The fossil records show that the horses possess evolution of the complex nature. Careful examination of the foot reveals that there is a gradual loss of toes in the front foot, and this is the broad changes in the feet. The fossil record also shows the largest vertebrates well adapted to the marine life in Eocene. However, the major radiation in whale evolution took place in Miocene. With this, we have covered the organic evolution and the life through Cambrian, Paleozoic, Mesozoic and Cenozoic. Thank you. Have a nice day.